Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today we are going to start chapter number 19. It is about material management. So we are going to discuss material management. In this chapter, we will discuss how to plan for the material management, what is the material management process, or how we make subcontract for material management with the suppliers. We will discuss about purchase order or shipping order, invoice, types of materials, and the how to make order materials, and then what is the approval process. Then we will also discuss related to fabrication and delivery of materials, installation of materials, types of materials. So today's topic is about construction material management on construction projects. Okay. So allow me to say Bismillah, Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. To each one of you. So my dear students, as I said, we are going to discuss today material management. Okay. The chapter is about material management. This is chapter 19 of your textbook. So the way they are going to discuss, we will go through those, subheadings, headings and subheadings. So let's move to the first slide. Let's start with the simple things. So material management is planning, identification, procurement, storage, receiving and distribution of materials on a construction project. The purpose of material management is to assure that the right materials are in the right place, in the right quantities when needed. So whenever we need material on our construction site, because construction is, it's a complicated process. Sometimes you are building a road that is very far from your site office. So then required material should be available at that point, in the required quantities. If we are casting concrete, so we must know from the drawings how much is the concrete quantity we have to order from the batching plant, and that quantity of concrete with the required concrete strength and slump. So the material should be available on site, along with the equipment required, or maybe whatever the labor crews or labor, how many labor will work for placing that materials. The goal of material management is to ensure that construction materials are available at their point of use when needed. Poor material management can result in increased cost during construction. So if we have poor material management, shortage of material, or materials are not available on site and worker are standing idle and equipment is also standing idle, so this is going to increase the cost of our project. So material management in construction is shown in figure. So next figure is going to show that material management, we have to plan for material management. Okay, how much material, what kind of material we need, what type of material we need, how much quantities we need. So we should be do the planning and do the estimation from the drawings. Then we place an order for purchasing of those material. So do the procurement, because there could be a lot of suppliers in the market. We have to select and make contact with the requisite supplier, and they should be able to supply the required quantity of material with the required quality of that materials. So what kind of, from where we have to purchase, who will be our supplier? So about the quantity, so all this we are going to discuss about material procurement. Once material is going to arrive on site, we should inspect those materials. As soon as material is going to arrive on site, we should check those materials that they are of right quality. So then we can we should pay attention on the storage. So how we have to store those material, because every material have different strategies to store, you know, how, if you have to store cement on site or some reinforcement or some other materials. So see, cement is like with the moisture, it's going to set, you know. So we have to avoid that material should, cement should not set with the in contact of moisture. Or reinforcement, if we are receiving reinforcement, so we should store at a different number of bars, the diameter, keep separate, you know, so that we can, you know, during the bar bending, we can issue those material easily, you know, and they should be also above the ground level, you know, usually 150 millimeter, 15 centimeter above the ground level, so those rebar should not touch with the moisture or with the ground. Similarly, then we have to issue those materials, you know, so from the storage, and then the materials sometime like we have to do fabrication, you know, for steel, especially for steel structures, steel frame. So if we are using edge section or angle sections, or we are going to prepare truss. So, or it's like spun piles. So it's there is a lot of fabrication involved. You know, we have to like even we have to make a reinforcement ready for the column or beam. So we have to prepare cut length. So this all we discuss in how we are going to fabricate, you know, materials, and then those material, how those trusses or precast elements will be installed on site. Okay, so by using crane, or if we are using a tower crane, so we are going to install those materials. So with this, let's move forward with the simple things, inshallah. So here is the production material, production planning is the first step in manufacturing planning and control. So when we are going to supply materials from those factories. So production planning is the first step in the manufacturing planning and control system. Production must satisfy the demand of the marketplace. It does so by using plant, machinery, equipment, labor, and materials as efficiently as possible. Okay. Master production schedule must satisfy customer demand. So our schedule must satisfy customer demand, like the material manufacturing industries, and they supply materials, so they should be able to produce, satisfy the demand of those materials for the project. Like those, how many batching plant they should have to supply concrete for large projects. Today, the concept of just-in-time manufacturing stresses the need to supply customers with what they want, when they want it, and to keep inventories at a minimum. So just-in-time is a good idea that you should keep, do not store a lot of material on site. So bring those materials that we can use within a week. So by this way, there will be less wastage of materials, you know, on site, or like reinforcement also with the passage of time get rusted or corrosion. So we have to avoid these things for materials. Since independent demand is not related to the demand for any other assemblies or products, it must be calculated. So we have to calculate the quantities of material from the drawings accurately, then we can order, let's say, for example, how much concrete we need for casting concrete for today. Okay, so batching plant, we must be able to calculate the right quantity to order the material or concrete, fresh concrete from the batching plant. The risk in carrying inventory are obsolescence, damage, pilferage, and starvation. So see, if we are going to store a lot of material on site, so materials sometimes they are like no more in competition, you know, they get damage, vandalism. So some people they steal, people can steal material, you know, from site, or deterioration can occur, you know, with the passage of time, those materials. So we should apply the just-in-time philosophy for the material storage on site. So material management process. Okay, so this is like the main topic we are going to discuss. A properly implemented material management program can achieve the timely flow of materials and equipment to the job site, and thus facilitate improved planning, increased labor productivity, better schedule, and lower project cost. So the three parties, like the owner, the architect or the engineer, so the design professional, and the contractor or constructor, so maybe builder, work on the project to complete it. So three parties, one is owner and the other is the engineer or the, you can say architect or maybe you can say consultant. So second party, one is owner, lawyer, so first party. Second is the consultant or the architect engineer, and third is the contractor, builder or constructor. So three parties, they have to work together on a project to complete the project in harmony. So the line of communication between these three parties and a traditional contract are shown in next figure 19.2. So this like so it's always constructor or the builder, they need to communicate with the owner. Okay? They need to get approval from the architect or from the engineer, okay? Or from the consultant. So they will submit everything for every material to the engineer or the consultant to get approval. Okay? So similarly, for any change orders or anything, so consultant need to discuss, or the architect engineer need to discuss with the owner to give approval for those variation orders or change orders. So all three parties have to work on any construction project together in harmony to complete the project with good quality and according to the contract or on time. So continuing with the material process, is materials are subject to review by the architect, engineer or the design professional. So every material shall be reviewed and checked and approved that it is going to comply with the specification of the project. So then they are going to give approval. A contractor usually delegate responsibility of some work to subcontractors and suppliers. Okay, the prime contractor on a project, usually they are going to delegate their responsibility to the subcontractors or suppliers. The subcontractors are suppliers, those who work under the prime contractor, or maybe some supplier who supply those materials. So all those materials supplied by the subcontractors or suppliers, they also have to be approved by the consultant or the design professional. So it means that everything done by the subcontractor or suppliers, it's supposed to be like it's being done by the prime contractor, the main contractor of the project. So material, continue with the material management process. As a result of this delegation, a distinct life cycle evolved for material on a project as shown in figure 19.3. So we have like every material has to be like the prime contractor, they have to place order, and that those materials should be go through the approval process with the consultant by having those drawings. And in the order, we will discuss in detail what is like purchase order or shipping order or invoice. So these kind of things we are going to discuss. And in the approval process, like what we need to submit to get approval from the consultant. Then for some materials, there will be a fabrication and delivery process, like how they are going to fabricate those steel frame or steel structure or truss. There is a precast elements, for example, piling or maybe precast wall. So then how those materials should be installed on site, on the project site. So their lifting mechanism and their installation mechanism. Are we going to use a tower crane or other cranes to install those, to install those precast girders, eye girders, or maybe some box girders or something? So we are we do we need to use launcher or something to if we are constructing an elevator road. So these kind of things we are going to discuss, and this figure is going to like explain the whole chapter of what we are going to discuss in detail about the material management process. So as a result of delegation, a distinct life cycle evolve for material on a project, as is shown in figure 19.3. Material management process comprises on ordering material. So we have to order material, and then approval process, fabrication and delivery, and installation of materials. So the process will flow and go this way. So the ordering materials, okay, construction contract between owner and contractor. So usually when we have a construction contract, usually a prime contract is between the owner and the prime contractor or the main contractor. Okay, so we make a construction contract. Then depending on we will have subcontractors. So contract between prime contractor and subcontractors, or contract between prime contractor or suppliers. Okay, so this they may use a standard contract agreement or a purchase order. So they can use this, you know, sometimes these subcontracts are very big, and they are also using the same kind of forms for a contract agreement, just like the prime contractor. They have used those forms to make contract between the owner and the prime contractor. So some subcontract, they are so big that they are going to use the same form. But for small contract, they are going to use a purchase order. Okay. Purchase order may be simple or complex as the construction contract. So purchase order is a very simple form, couple of pages. We will discuss in detail what is purchase order. Or it could be as complex as a contract between the owner and the prime contract, owner of the main contract. So simple purchase orders are used on a cash and carry basis and to document the purchase for record keeping and cost accounting. So simple, sometimes we use just only simple purchase orders. So we use procure material on cash and we use that purchase order. So to keep that record keeping or for the purpose of cost accounting on the project. So the purchase order is a purchase contract. So what is purchase order? Purchase order is a purchase contract between the contractor and the supplier. Okay. So it could be a purchase order, could be a contract between the contractor and the subcontractor. It describes the material to be supplied. So purchase order is going to describe how much material has to be supplied, how much is their quantity, and the amount of the purchase order. So how much total amount for this purchase. Okay, a typical purchase order forms. So there are three purchase order forms are shown in figure 19.4, 19.5, and 19.6. Like we have this purchase order. So in this purchase order, like they should, issuing authority, they should have their address and they should sign it. The issuing authority, and they should put the address of the vendor and date and like how they are going to deliver this purchase order, and then put a description should be there on article detail. The quantity should be mentioned, UP as unit price should be mentioned, amount of the purchase order should be mentioned, and the cost code. Okay. So at the bottom, so this should be accepted by the vendor. It should accept this and it should be signed by the competent authority or the project manager who is going to issue the purchase order from the contractor side to for the vendor or for the subcontractors. So this is one sample. So let's see the other sample also, purchase order, that is purchase order. We have a purchase order. So here we will put the address of a vendor, and then it should have the item number and quantity and description, unit price and amount should be mentioned. So and how they will shift this purchase order to the company. So job number they can put, the mailing address they can put, their telephone number, and it should be signed by the project manager and should be accepted by the vendor or the supplier. Okay. So it should also mention like number of shop drawings attached or samples attached with this purchase order. So it should be like a mini subcontractor. Okay, purchase order should be a mini subcontractor between the prime contractor and the subcontractors or the suppliers. Again, another purchase order. So here is the company who is issuing the purchase order. The person who requested this one or who approved this purchase order. So they have some terms here mentioned for this purchase order, like 30 days, their phone number is mentioned, or their payment terms should be, we can write in detail, some notes we can put here, detail about if there is some special instructions for the purchase order, what will be like, how will be the shipping, or is there any discount, or what will be the invoicing procedure. So, and then it should be mention the quantity, okay, item name, and their cost code, okay, their quantities, their unit price, if there is some discount, and then total price, and then it should mention the total amount of the purchase order. So purchase order, the basic elements of a purchase order are that in every, what you have seen in the previous slides about samples of the purchase order. So you must have observed that there is a quantity required as mentioned, there is a description about this contract. It's like a mini contract, so a description should be given in detail about those materials, but we are going to order, unit price, there is payment term should be mentioned, how they have to pay the payment, within how many days, if there is a special instructions required, like a shipping requirement, or there is a discount or invoicing procedure, so that this purchase order may be valid for next 15 days. So if this is the offer from the purchase order, like quotation is given from the supplier side, so they can mention that this price mentioned in the purchase order will be applicable for next 15 days or 1 month, then the prime contractor should accept this, every order, like they are time bound, so they can put that in payment terms, and then both it should be signed by the agents, like who is authorized agent from the contractor side, or who is the authorized person from the supplier side, or from the subcontractor side. Okay, now in the purchase order, there are some things that we should be familiar. So one term we are going to use is free on board. Free on board, FOB, is a point at which a vendor makes goods available for purchase. Like if you are going to buy a mobile phone, so these vendors like a Jareer store or extra, store, so they are going to display those mobile phones at their extra store. So that will be like place where people can see those materials. Similarly for construction, where those they are going to display those material, like in the factory place, location of the factory, so project manager can go to inspect those material reinforcement, say for example in the reinforcement factory, the steel factory. So free on board, it specifies that the ownership is transferred to the purchaser at a location where the goods made available to the purchaser. The vendor will present the goods at the vendor sales location, factory, or the purchaser's job site. So maybe they will, the supplier will bring some samples material at the job site of the project. So then they can, based on those samples, they can make agreement, you know. Or they go to the factory, you know, the steel reinforcement factory, and then buy the steel reinforcement. So wherever they make application, where they make agreement, if then it means sometime when they make agreement, so ownership is transferred to the purchaser. Free on board is the term used in shipping terms where the seller quotes a price including the cost of delivering goods to the nearest port. Okay? The buyer bears all the shipping expenses and is responsible to get the product from that port to its final destination. So sometimes, you know, it's we'll discuss in the next slide. Sometimes what happens is like we buy those material and the seller is going to say that, okay, they will deliver this material at this point. Okay? From that point, then to the project site, so the a project manager or the buyer, they should manage how to transport that material to their site. So this we will discuss in the next slide about this, you know, shipping, when we discuss this shipping contract or bill of lading. So second term we are going to use is bill of lading, is a contractual agreement between a common carrier. Bill of lading is a contractual agreement between a common carrier and a shipper to move a specified item from point A to a point B at the contracted price. So it's like it's a shipping contract. Sometimes you buy material, you know, from outside, like in Riaz, they have this metro project and they bought this tunnel boring machine, you know. So maybe if they bought tunnel boring machine from Germany, so then from where they have bought and for that tunnel boring machine should be shipped to Saudi Arabia. It will come to Jeddah port and from there it will come to Riyadh. So all these things will be like discussed in the bill of lading. Bill of lading outlines the journey of your cargo from the origin to the destination. This is issued by a carrier to a shipper to detail the method and path of shipment and is used as a contract for the movement of the cargo. So it's like same like we use book cargo, you know, with on aeroplane, or there are cargo companies that deliver materials for trade from one country to other company, other country materials or goods. So they use this term bill of lading, like they do the shipment of those materials. So here we are going to discuss this, you know, what is CIF and what is COD. And so how this purchase order is going to make effect to the purchaser or the seller. So a purchase is specified as cost, insurance, and freight. Cost, insurance, and freight. So this is the abbreviation is CIF. Cost, insurance, and freight. Second is like cost on delivery, COD, cost on delivery. Cash on delivery. Okay. So CIF is the cost, insurance, and freight. Like the, it's for the material, how much is the cost, how much is the insurance for that material, and how much is the transportation cost. Freight is transportation. Our second is the cash on delivery, COD, cash on delivery. The sequence of event in CIF and COD transactions are shown in this figure. So what we are going to discuss, like the first we see the CIF, cost, insurance, and freight. So what happened that there is a vendor location, then they make agreement and this title of purchase passes to the owner. Okay, so the owner, purchaser become the owner of that material. And later on is the shipment. Okay, so this company will say, okay, we will ship this material to your project site. Okay, but the title of ownership passed on to the owner, okay, to the buyer or to the project manager of the project. So if the second is that cash on delivery. Okay, so there is a vendor location and then there is a shipment also. And then after shipment, when material arrived on site, okay, then title passes with the payment. Okay, So then, once material arrived on site, then project manager of the construction project or the contractor, the project manager is going to pay to those vendors or suppliers money for the cash after cash on delivery. So once they have delivered that material. So it means in the second, usually project manager prefer the second cash on delivery, that suppliers or vendors, they should deliver those materials on site, and then they will pay the money that material is safely arrived on site with the required quantities and quality and all these things. So then, but in the first, when the title passes to the purchaser, so later is shipment, because there is the insurance involved, and if there is some accident, that shipment, ship sink, anything can happen, So if there is a, like transportation is maybe just with the truck, so truck get accident on the way. So then there are like insurance has to pay those, that material is the shipment is insured. So then insurance company is involved in that one. So usually the project managers, they prefer that for construction projects, project manager, they want that they should have the material, they should receive the material on site. So it means the purchasing cost and shipment cost, then material once arrived on site, then they are going to pay the title parcel with the payment. So they are going to pay on cash on delivery. Similarly below, because they are like the purchase order. So they have the purchase order like the contract price. So then there is a bill of lading, mean the shipment contract, the shipment cost. And once the material arrive on site, so at the end is the invoice. Invoice will include the price and the shipment cost or whatever the insurance involved or whatever taxes are involved. So that bill, it's like fatura, in Arabic. So that money should be paid with all the required taxes. So we will see some samples of the invoice also in the next coming slide, inshallah. Let's see first the shipping order. So bill of lading, this is like an example for the typical bill of lading or shipping order is shown in figure 19.8 and 19.9. So this is like the sample of shipping order or the bill of lading shown here. So it's like a shipping name of the company is given, and then is like their contact number, their date of shipment, there is what time they have your order number, order date and our order number. So it's which should be written, and what is the item or quantity order, the description of that material, quantity of shipment. So number of cartons, boxes, so total weight and packed by, so who make the packing for this delivery of this material. They should also sign. So what, who has packed this one, I put date and check by and date, and then like they have to put packed and shipped above procedure. So then they will make shipment. So they have to return this copy to the office that material is there now in a transit or it's moving, to the project site or the delivery point. So this is like a bill of lading or a shipping order. Another example of the same is given here, that we have a shipping order and shipper's number. Shipper's number is given. Sorry. And it's name of the carrier. Carrier number is given. Okay. So CA the consigned with the delivery destination, state, zip code, country, address, what will be the route, delivery carrier, whether it's a car or a vehicle, its number. So what is the package number or description, reinforcing steel accessories, then is class or rate is written, weight is written, checked by similarly this is the thing, signature of the consignor, and then receive who received this one or agent's signature. So who make this shipping order, and then who will receive this when they are going to receive. Okay, so this will be attached with the shipment. So this we have seen two examples of the shipping order. Let's see the invoice. Invoice is like when materials are delivered to the site, so there will be a payment for the final amount and with including the taxes. Materials invoice is a bill that lists the details of a purchase of goods and services. It is a commercial document that is issued by a seller to a buyer. It includes the amount and all taxes. Okay? It will include all the amount and all the taxes. A typical billing document or invoice is shown in figure 19.10 and 19.11. Okay? So there are two examples we are going to show. Here is the invoice. Who is going to issue this invoice, like the from if material has been by the vendor. So date, they put the invoice number, and they have the where they are going to send this invoice bill to. So then it should have sales representative name, shipping date, how they have shipped, so any terms, due date, a product ID, description, quantity, unit price, total, and then subtotal. Then is like if in USA they have like provincial sales tax, from the state sales tax, and then general sales tax from the central government. And if there is any shipping and handling charges, so we should include, and then the total amount. Okay, so including all the taxes. Okay, so invoice will be total amount including all the taxes. Another example of invoice is also given, like there should be who is going to issue this invoice, company name and their address, zip code, their phone number, contact numbers, to whom they are going to send this invoice, so their name and company name, street address, zip code, phone number, email address should be given. And then invoice number and date, if they have the customer ID, if they have terms, any conditions for this, so they write the description here, and quantity of those materials, unit price, and total amount. At the end, they will make the subtotal and then include what is the tax rate. Okay, like sometime, like in Saudi Arabia, VAT is 15%. So maybe some country 10% or 5%. Here it mentioned is 4.25%. Okay, so then total tax on this amount is with this tax rate, how much total amount and the total price. So this will be like the final final cost of those materials. So with the invoice. So we have discussed this now. We are going to discuss the approval process of materials. Okay, approval process of materials. So approval process, consultant or the design professional, they have to give approval of all the materials. So submittal consists of information provided by the contractor to the design professional or consultant for approval of materials and equipment before they are fabricated and delivered to the project. So we need to get approval. If some material should be fabricated, we have to prepare the truss also. So the consultant should approve the angle irons, those sections that will be used for assembling or fabricating the truss. Okay. So it's and there are different shop drawings So if there is a, we need to, you know, there are the working drawings or design drawings. So based on the design drawings, contractor will prepare the shop drawings on site. Contractor will prepare the shop drawings. So each shop drawings we will discuss in detail in the next slide probably. So then all shop drawings will be according to the design drawings, and they have more details about the bar bending schedule or cut length and how each bar will be bent, what is the shape. So the, for the whatever the, you know, where they, that reinforcement should be put in the foundation or in the column or in the beams. So in, it will show the detail of each rebar and its shape also, how they will cut the bars, how they are going to bend and give the proper shape. So the consultant or design professional have to give approval for the shop drawings. Similarly, for some other item like product data. So for some materials like paints, they have to product data meet the contract specification. So they need to present product data for any epoxy concrete or any paints, varnishes, distemper, like material for the sanitary material, plumbing, water supply, pumps, motors, equipment. So all these kind of things, they have to present the product data, you know, from the manufacturer. Okay. Just like we go to the medical store, you know, in each medical, when we buy a medicine, so inside is the data sheet, you know, that we can read and get information about that medicine. Similarly, for each these, when we buy any equipment or any, electronic thing, so there is inside is a product data sheet that explain about that electronic. Maybe it's a printer or computer or any pump or any sanitary related things or escalator or air conditioning system, whatever, you know. So we have to present that product data sheet to the consultant to get approval. Similarly, there are some third things. So for some time we submit the samples, okay. The physical examples of the material supplied. So physical examples, like say for example, in the classroom, we need to buy chairs for the students. So maybe then what kind of chairs we need? So the supplier will present the actual sample of those chairs. Okay. So this chair is this shape, another chair is this shape, another chair is this shape. No, the owner or purchaser can select which chair they like. Okay. So the, like a physical example of material supplied, the quality and quantity of samples might vary according to the material type. So quality and quantity of samples, like sometimes we need for the reinforcement also. If we buy reinforcement, we test the rebars, you know, for tensile strength, and we take those rebars for tensile strength in the universal testing machine. So how much is the tensile strength of the steel reinforcement? 60,000 psi or 40,000 psi, whatever, you know. So we take an actual sample of those. Okay. Similarly, we take when we cast concrete, we make an actual sample, like we cast the cylinders or cubes. Okay. So then we test those concrete cubes or cast concrete cylinders after 3 days or after 7 days or 28 days strength. So it's like physical samples we have to present, and that we have to present those physical samples and get approval from the consultant. So this is for approval process of all kinds of materials. Now let's see the some more detail about the approval process of shop drawings. Okay, so shop drawings, as we discussed, that there should be a 3 to 6 copies of shop drawings should be prepared, 1 to 5 days for review. So they, it depends that contractor should submit those shop drawings to the consultant, to the design professional, to the architect engineer, and they should check each bar diameter and length and each, they usually use different colors, for yellow color and orange color and this thing. So whatever they have to check each dimension on those shabna that it is according to the design drawing. So once they are going to check, you know, when they approve like the 3 to 6 copies, so some copies will go to the, you know, one copy will remain with the consultant, other will go to the contractor, one may be submitted to the owner, and the one copy will go to the who is going to bar bending schedule subcontractors. So one copy should be displayed in the office of the contractor. So this is in like the distribution of those copies. And then usually this consultant, they, if everything is okay, they approve that shop drawing. Okay, they say the stamp and approve. Then approved with noted correction. Okay, sometimes they wrote approved with noted correction. So it means they have approved, but there is a minor correction. So, but they have approved this drawing and there is no need for any other submission. Approved with noted correction, but final submission is required. Final submittal is required. So now they approved with noted correction, but they want that you should submit a final drawing again, and that final will be issued to the site for construction. So they can say not approved, resubmit again. So they not approved, resubmit again if there are a lot of mistakes there. So contractor, prime contractor have to submit those again, you know. So each drawing is usually, you know, who is going to submit? Three engineers you have to sign, you know, submitted by, okay, from the contractor side, engineer will sign that one. Okay. Who is going to check that from the consultant side, the engineer who checked that one, and who is going to approve from the consultant side, like the project manager of the consultant, so they should also sign. Usually from the contractor sign also, like junior engineer, they sign, and then their senior engineer is going to check, and then they are going to submit. Okay, so they then is checked by from the consultant side, and who is going to give the approval from the consultant side or from the design professional side or the architect or engineer side. Okay, so each the name of those engineers and their signatures with there should be there. You know, usually each drawing have one on the block. You know, where it's written that okay, this is the project name, this is the consultant name for this project, contractor name of this project, owner is this one, then this drawing is about what related to what, you know, whether it's a structural drawing or architectural drawing or plumbing drawing or whatever, you know. So then there is a column that they have to be submitted by, checked by, and approved by. So this is what we have discussed, approval process of shop drawings. So let us move forward. Then after having this, we are going to discuss now the fabrication and delivery process. Okay, so as we have seen in the beginning that we, sorry, that we discuss, okay, order, like purchase order and shipping order, and then invoice and approval process. So next we are going to discuss is fabrication and delivery. After 4 phases of material life cycle shown in figure 19.3, the fabrication and delivery process is the most critical. Okay? Fabrication and delivery process is the most critical. Contractor give time to control and monitor the fabrication and delivery process. So prime contractor, they have to give time to those subcontractors who have to fabricate those materials. Like say, for example, structural steel frame or a truss, if there is a bending, cutting and bending of those elements are is involved, so then they have to deliver. Okay. When construction materials are delivered to the project site, they should be inspected as soon. They should be inspected as soon after delivery on the project site. So those materials, they should be once the materials are received on the construction site, they should be inspected. Okay, every material should be inspected that it is going to conform to the specifications. materials are checked for compliance with the approved submittals as regard to quality, quantity, dimensions, and other requirements of the specifications. Okay. So every material, like they have, if there is a fabrication involved, so what we get the approval that we will use these you know, H section or L section. So then we have got the approval. Then in the same fabrication, the same L section or H section should be used. Or if there is a rivets or welding is involved, so how they are going to make a connection to those things. How they are going to make a connection with those elements with the rivets or with the plates, so joints, all everything should be according to the specifications. Then after this, there is a storage and delivery. Storage and delivery. One of the big problem on building site is the large amount of material wastage. Okay, if there is a lot of material wastage revolve around positioning and ordering of material, receipt and checking of deliveries from the suppliers, offloading and handling of those materials, storing and protecting those materials, and issuing and distributing those materials, and how their materials are being used on the project. Okay. Managers need to take steps to avoid wastage of the materials. Okay. So managers, they need to pay attention that they should be not wastage of materials, so then they can order, like manage by ordering the cut length to the company for reinforcement, how much length they need for the column and beams or slabs. And they have to protect material like from theft and pilferages of material can also be safeguarded. Okay. Employ a full-time security guard on the site. So there should be an alarm system should be installed on the site, and site should have proper lighting. Okay. Proper lighting at night, you know, for the security people. There should be alarm system. If somebody touch the door, so alarm should start ringing. No, for material in the storage room. So we need to protect those materials. Okay, let's move. For material purchase, inventory control is important to minimize the total cost. Okay, so obviously we have to, you know, for storage, we have to control the inventory. We should not store a lot of material on site that it should get rusted or whatever. Different types of materials have different storage requirements. For example, any contact with direct or airborne moisture. Any contact with the direct or airborne moisture can cause cement to set. So it must be kept dry. Okay, we have to store cement on the site. It must be kept dry. Store steel rebar, another material they are giving example is store steel bars, steel rebars above ground level by at least 150 millimeter, okay, 15 centimeter. Upon platform to prevent it from deterioration and corrosion. Okay. So we should store those reinforcement also, like different size of bars on different places, so that it will be easy when we have to issue those material for cut length or for making bar bending schedule. And then they should be above the ground level, okay, above the ground level, so that it should not get moisture, and it should not see reinforcement, should not be corroded, corrosion should not flow. So we have to store under the roof, not in the open space. Okay. So sometimes, you know, cloudy or weather or rain, so that this will make our reinforcement rusty. You know? The installation process involves the physical incorporation of material items into the project. So now installation process, we may have to use a crane or tower crane or whatever, you know, depending upon what kind of material we are handling. So we are casting concrete with the concrete pump or with the tower crane with the bucket. So we have to how we are going to install those material when material are going to become part of the project. Material should be handled with care and following the safety instructions. Okay, so especially when we are dealing with the trusses or precast girders, precast elements, precast walls, lifting mechanism, and we have to follow the safety instructions to lift all those material and install all those material at the proper place. Okay, so we have to follow the safety instructions or how we have to lift those material and install those like precast girder or steel girders or whatever, you know, for the bridges or for there is a precast panel. Lot of things are going to be precast elements. You know? Maybe even from starting from the precast piles, okay, spun piles, then precast walls, precast panel, precast slabs. So there are not many things these days are happening like precast elements. So how we have to handle those material precast elements with the installation process. Now we are going to discuss something like they have a separate thing in the knowledge box. They are going to discuss like students should be familiar with the fiber reinforced polymer rebars. So what they discuss here, mentioned that in USA 40% of bridges are structurally deficient due to cracking and collision. So there is a lot of cracking and collision for all those old bridges. Steel corrosion is avoided with the use of glass fiber reinforced polymers. Okay, so we can avoid steel corrosion if we use these rebars. Like this is they are going to put the example, this is a dockyard or dry dock, so Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. So they have taken out water. Okay, now they say this steel is rusted and this berth is they are going to do the repair work. They are going to do the repair work. So to avoid rusting, they mentioned that it's preferable that we should use a glass fiber reinforced polymer rebar. So if we paint like this with the glass fibers, so then these steel rebars, they will not get rusted or they will not catch corrosion, and they are more durable, you know, for a long time. So this is we can use these fiber reinforced polymer rebars, okay, with the glass fiber reinforced polymers for the steel rebars, and then they will not get the corrosion. They will be long lasting, durability will increase. Now, in the last section, we are going to discuss the material types, okay. So, we divide materials into three main types. Bulk materials, okay. Second is standard material item. Third is fabricated material items, okay. So simple things like bulk materials, we say require little or no fabrication. Bulk materials, say for example aggregate, sand, okay, masonry, these kind of things, we call it all those bulk materials, okay. Concrete masonry units or bricks, so these kind of materials we call it bulk materials. Standard material items. Manufacturers' standard items require some fabrication. So now those manufacturers, they have manufactured these brick paving blocks like for the walkways. Then there is the water supply equipment, plumbing fixtures, waterproofing paints. So the manufacturer, they have these standard materials. Okay. Now there is a fabricated materials fabricated for a particular project or structural, for example, structural steel. Okay. So fabricated materials, we are using like these, all these precast materials, maybe a truss or steel frame or whatever, you know, so there is a lot of fabrication involved. Even for the bridges, we have these parapet or barriers, median barriers for the road structure. So we are using fabricated materials. So let's see a little bit more detail about these types. So first is bulk materials. Okay, bulk material examples are like cement, crushed stones, soil, sand, trucks of sand. So paving materials, ready mix concrete, wire mesh, for the you know who use the for binding binding wires, or there is a mesh net we use to in the concrete pours where we have to stop like casting concrete for a slab and then the next slab. So we are using wire mesh masonry bricks, okay, or concrete masonry units, electric conduits. So these are bulk materials. So usually maybe they need just one day from placing the purchase order until the delivery of the material, or maybe up to 5 days. Okay, so depending upon how far is your vendor or supplier, so they can supply these bulk materials. Okay, so delivery time is 1 to 5 days. Then standard materials. So for standard materials, submittals are required to the consultant. Submittal requires shop drawing, product data, and performance data, and samples. So product data, performance data, or we are going to submit the samples, to the consultant to get approval. So examples of these materials will be like brick paving for walkways or paving block. like footpath, standard structural steel members. So the structural steel member, L section, I section, or H sections for making truss or you know steel frame. Then there is a special doors are available from the market. So factories they prepare those doors for steel or for wood or for other materials. And then there is a metal frame windows, available, standard sizes, paints, waterproofing materials, fire protection equipment, water supply equipment, walls, plumbing fixtures, like wash basins, you know, WC, so it's escalator that we use in the building, escalator and pumps. So all these we call it standard materials. Okay. Similarly, there could be like for HVAC, heating, ventilation, air conditioning. So some standard materials are available. So these we need 3 to 12 weeks delivery time. Okay. So we have to check with our supplier how much time they need to deliver these materials, whether they have to manufacture or especially for this project. Okay. So it's and maybe you know it could be in some areas that could be obtained quickly, and some areas project site is in the remote area away from the urban area, so it takes time, you know, to make these placing a purchase order until getting those material on site. So last is a fabricated material. Submittal requires detailed shop drawings, product and performance data, and samples also. So fabricated materials that we have to submit a shop drawing to the consultant, or product data, or performance data, or we have to submit the samples for those fabricated materials. So examples of fabricated materials are like switchboards and panels, transformers, structural steel frame, reinforcement for piling, column or footing. So like they make the bar bending schedule and then fix that reinforcement with the binding wires and bring it on site, say for example, for the bore piling, they will bring it for the bore piling. So, and similarly for the column, lower part column, upper part column. So they bring those steel cages and then install on site. Okay, then they fix the formwork and cast concrete. Or they are using precast concrete elements. Maybe they are precast elements, fabricated element like eye girders, okay, precast roof, precast wall panels are available. A special for metals, lighting fixture like chandelier lights that you have seen, big lights, especially in the mosque, you know, in the middle or in big hall, you know, chandelier. there is an electric heater or fire alarm equipment. So all these things are fabricated materials, you know, for the project. So we need to see what material we need for our project. Okay. And then manufacturing and delivery, it takes 2 to 12 weeks. Okay, 2 to 12 weeks, depending upon. So you need to sit with your supplier and decide okay, how much material you need, how much delivery time should be, fabrication time, yes, and delivery time. So that material should be available for your project according to the requirement and according to the project specifications on time. So this is the last slide. They are going to mention here, like a couple of photographs are given. It's road and port facilities. Say, for example, they have to work for road and port facilities. Sometimes, you know, people are working on this sea, you know, in the sea, and they have to do work. And so it means all the materials, labor crews, and the plated equipment should be available. You know? Similarly, in this figure, like this is also a port, the construction of port facilities. So caustic concrete, this is a bridge construction, road construction. See, they are working very far from their site office. Okay, so when they cast concrete, sometimes just a concrete vibrator is missing, and then they are away from the site or just missing a vibrator. So they are waiting for the vibrator, then they can cast concrete. You know? So we have to do good material management, equipment management, labor management to have to keep our cost low. You know? So what they have written, it's simple. Material must be available at their point of use when needed. Poor material management can result in increased cost due to labor and equipment standing idle at the construction site. For example, labor crews waiting for vibrator to compact the concrete. The labor crew, they are waiting for the vibrator to compact the concrete. So it's they are away from the site office. So every equipment, concrete pump, labor crews, vibrator, everything should be. You know, we have to organize in a good way. And we need to do good material management to complete our project with less cost. Okay, so otherwise, if we are not doing, our materials, they are not going to qualify. Are we using poor material or low quality materials, and then they are going to fail? So we have to do rework. And these things are going to, create a lot of problems with the reputation of the contractor. So we have to pay attention to all these things. So we discuss, gentlemen, with material management, chapter 19. Inshallah, next time we will discuss another chapter. And then this course will be, is going to finish, inshallah. Okay. So just one chapter is left about probably about safety. You know, we are going to discuss next. So with this, thank you very much for your attention. To all the engineers, I hope this will be, of course, in the class, we have a lot of time to discuss things and to give answer to the students to their questions. But I'm going to put a recording that if students need, they can, watch this YouTube video for their preparation. If they have any difficulty, so they of course they can come to see the teacher office hours, but they can also watch videos to see these lectures about what is about material management chapter 19. So with this, thank you very much for your attention, and I hope that other engineers whoever will watch this video, it will be helpful for them in the construction industry, for all those engineers. So with this, I would like to say thank you for your attention. So try to, because I'm making this effort, so you can subscribe also to my channel, and then let your friends also, if somebody is interested, so let them know to, they can watch this video and get benefit. With this, allow me to say subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Thank you very much.